Joe.
Blackula.
Stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused.
And I'm your host, Dennis Stein.
Subscribe to the Focus Talk TV YouTube channel. Follow at Focus Talk TV on Instagram and Twitter, and join in on the conversation on the Focus Talk TV Facebook page. And in the meantime, remember to stay focused.
Do you know this rise in homosexuality and lesbianism and transgender and LGBT and Q? That's not an accident.
Now, in this book, he highlights how the CIA was chemically treating young black people through prisons, particularly, and making them, on one hand, super predators.
Yes, sir.
It's a scientific experiment.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, President Trump, if you're going to bring your generals and your army into Chicago to kill our young savages.
Yes, sir, brother.
I'm sending this book to the White House. Before you come, read it. Give it to General Mad Dog Mattis and read it before you come. Because you've got to learn how white people, your people,
that's right,
destroyed black youth.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, brother.
In a chemical experiment. From the CIA, this rotten, no good bastard of a government.
Yes, sir.
You're in tune to Chicago's most popular college music radio station, 89.3 is WKKC. This is Focus Talk, the thought-provoking, solution-oriented talk show, daring to make a difference in our communities. We're talking on a regular basis because the answers really matter. What are we talking about? Well, we're talking about politics, religion, personal development, education, history, music, and then from time to time, we are spotlighting positive people who are doing positive things right here in the Inglewood community, all across the Chicagoland area, as well as the entire United States. I'm your host, Dennis Snyder. Joining me in the studio today is Dr. Wesley Muhammad. Dr. Wesley, how are you today?
I'm well, Brother Dennis, and yourself?
I am well. Thank you so very much for being here and being a part of today's show and giving us some information. Let's start from the very beginning, Dr. Wesley. Are you a Chicago native?
I am not, no. The Honorable Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan brought me here to Chicago in 2012. So come May, I'm going on 6 years. I don't know how long it takes to indigenize or to be a card-carrying Chicagolander, But 6 years it will be for me in May.
Okay. And now, where are you originally from?
From Detroit, Michigan.
Detroit, okay. Yes, all right.
Though I came here directly from Atlanta. I was in Atlanta for 10 years, and so I came here directly from Atlanta, but I'm from Detroit.
Okay. Now, your background as far as schooling is where?
Morehouse College in Atlanta for undergraduate school, and then I did graduate school in Ann Arbor, Michigan at the University of Michigan.
Okay. All right. And that's where you receive your doctorate?
It is. It is. Though I have to say, I did my first Arabic language training here in Chicago at the University of Chicago, a very memorial summer for me here in Chicago at the University of Chicago.
Okay. All right. Now, you were brought here by the nation. And so what is your official title?
Yes, sir. Student minister in the Nation of Islam. Member of the Executive Council of the Nation of Islam, which is the governing body of the nation under the direction and guidance of the Honorable Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan, as well as member of the research team of the Honorable Brother Minister Farrakhan.
Yes, sir. Okay. Now, Dr. Wesley, I want to talk about a myriad of different things today, but first I want to start off by talking about your book, Understanding the Assault on the Black Man, Black Manhood, and Black Masculinity.
Yes, sir.
Now, how long did it take you to write the book?
Well, that's interesting. The book descended upon me, Brother Dennis. It took a year, but that's really deceptive. It's a year. I had to send my pregnant wife away. I had to send my children away. I was quarantined for a year. Talk about 17-hour days and nights, every single night for a year in the production of the book. However, it really culminates, Brother Dennis, 28 years of work and research. So on the literal sense, the physical sense, the book was in production for a year, an intense year, a non-normal year. But conceptually, the book has been in production for 28 years now.
28 years. What is its premise?
The premise is that black life in America today, specifically the black male, has been and is under an intense assault, deliberate assault, Brother Dennis, by the U.S. government, and what we call the Synagogue of Satan, a collaborated effort of Jews and Gentiles, wealthy Jewish persons, and elements of the United States government, a literal assault, scientific, economic, sociological, political assault against black America, but the black man in particular, our manhood and our masculinity. They're not the same thing. The title actually isn't redundant. The purpose, to put it in context, the point of the assault and why it's targeting the black man, our manhood and masculinity, is because the American white man is suffering from a crisis of masculinity. Sociologist Dr. Michael Kimmel describes this crisis of white American white masculinity as a homophobia. The American white man's fear of other men, that they will unmask his lack of manhood and masculinity. So in response to his crisis of white masculinity, he obsessively unmans every other man, which will threaten to expose his shady or compromised masculinity. And for the record, that's why we have Donald Trump as president. Donald Trump he rode into the White House as a consequence of this crisis of white masculinity. This is why the video release of his predatory nature against women, his sexual assaulting of white women, whereas the world thought that that was going to sink his candidacy, I submit that that is what solidified hit the presidency, because that and white women voted Donald Trump into office because white women have suffered under the crisis of American white masculinity as well. And Donald Trump, to these white people, personifies resurgent and confident white masculinity. Donald Trump is the answer to this crisis of white masculinity. So him bragging about sexually assaulting women, look how they characterize it. It's just locker room conversation. He's bragging about being a predator to women, but for white women who heard that, and white men who were suffering themselves from the crisis of white masculinity, he became the savior of white masculinity. And that's why we have President Donald Trump.
So now, Dr. Wesley, you said a mouthful there. You said a whole lot. But what I'm hearing is that, in short, that it's okay for him to behave in this manner because it reestablishes the fact that the white masculinity is in trouble.
That's right. And he's the fix. He's seen as the fix because all of Donald Trump's antics, and just recently he spoke to his base just yesterday.
Even if it's indecent?
He spoke to, but see, that makes the point. His base said that we like Donald Trump with all of the antics that we sane and civilized people are offended by, his base are inspired by, because they say he represents strength. See, that's the crisis of white masculinity speaking. When Donald Trump is the most vulgar, when he's the most abusive, when he is really on his bully tip, that's when his base is happiest. And who and what is his base? His base are white men feeling disenfranchised as men in white America, and the wives and girlfriends of those disenfranchised white men who are suffering from the seeming loss of white privilege in America.
So now, Dr. Wesley, how does the black man or the black woman play into the scheme of things in this whole scenario?
The Donald Trump, if you notice, who is described as the savior of white masculinity, he always finds himself at odds or attacking a black man, whether it's Colin Kaepernick or LeVar Ball. He has an obsession with attacking black men. Well, that's part of this crisis of white masculinity, because the singular threat to the exposing of the fragility of white masculinity is black masculinity. And of note, this is a global reality. Global white supremacy is threatened by black masculinity, which is why the demasculinization or the unmanning of the black male is actually a global project. It's not a local American phenomenon. It's a global project. Everywhere the white man has gone on the planet, he had to unman the local male population. He had to be the only man in town because he knows subconsciously that his manhood is questionable and compromised. So the black man here in America, sociologists say the black man in America is the Negro, is the lady of the races. It was sociologist Robert Park who said, who described the white Anglo-Saxon as a people, as the man of the races, industrious, pioneering, bellicose, or willing to go to war for a principle.
Mm-hmm.
Opposite that is the so-called, is the Negro people. The Negro is the lady of the races, always polite, artistic, don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. So this was a sociological paradigm that was spread around the world, that the black man in America is inherently effeminate vis-a-vis the American white man, who is the quintessential heterosexual masculine male. So in order to satisfy, in order to solve their crisis of white masculinity, this society has to eradicate black masculinity.
Now, Dr. Wesley, is any of that, could any of that be described as opinionated?
Yes, but opinionated backed up by a whole bunch of footnotes. A whole bunch of receipts. It's an opinion that comes with a lot of receipts.
Okay. So now, where does the work begin in relaying the information that you just so eloquently talked about to me, to the audience, getting that to the masses? Because for the most part, it's being said on a regular basis, well, the young black man is a knucklehead, he's wilding out, he's doing this, he's smoking weed, he's making a bunch of babies, he's not taking care of any of his babies, he's not in college, he's not doing anything. And so then it's being said, well, look at the statistics, look at the number of black men who are in jail, who are not doing anything with their children, who are not in college. They are basically proving our particular point.
Right, yes, sir. And what we document is precisely the context of all of the circumstances you just described. Black men are in jail in epidemic numbers, not because black men in America are inherently criminal, but because this government, starting with the Nixon administration through the Reagan administration, the Bush, and culminating with the Clinton administration, this government is criminal and has subjected black men to mass incarceration, purposely herding black men into prisons, not for economic and social control purposes. The prison became, after the 60s, the vehicle for racial social control. And so the mass incarceration phenomenon developed as a means of racial social control. So black men are in prison not because black men are criminal, because this government is criminal. Black men are too often unable to have a healthy relationship with the children that we bring into this world. Some of it is a problem among us that didn't start with us. We are suffering from wounds inflicted during slavery. When you make a human being, literally make him into a stud for 300 years, you force him to have babies that he's disallowed to care for. Not for a month, not for a century. For three centuries, the black male in America was deliberately made a stud, a breeder, and disallowed to be responsible for what he produces. And then you just say, all right, y'all free. But you don't repair the damage that those three centuries have produced. So yes, you got black men who, as a result of that ingrained training, slave training,
We have to work to be made responsible. But this work that we have to do, the burden is on us. But the problem that created, or the circumstance that created this problem, cannot be overlooked. It is a criminal society at the root of all of these sociological shortcomings that can be enumerated about the black man.
So now, Dr. Wesley, needless to say, we won't be able to solve the issue in this particular form. We have about 30 seconds left. What can we do now?
We have to be aware of the assault. The reason I wrote this book, Brother Dennis, every single day, every single one of us are victim of various mechanisms of this assault, and we don't know it. Being aware of the mechanisms of the assault. Everybody knows the black man is under assault. Black man gets a bad rap. But what we don't know is the mechanisms of the assault. Because if we knew it, we would realize that every day, each and every one of us are a victim of or a party to the mechanisms of this assault. So the most important thing is awareness. Awareness will allow us to disengage so much of this assault.
Dr. Wesley Muhammad on Focus Talk. Dr. Muhammad, thank you so very much for
being
here.
Thank you, Brother Dennis.
We'll talk again real soon.
Yes, sir.
You're in tune to Chicago's most popular college music radio station, 89.3 WKKC.
You're watching Focus Talk TV
with your host, Dennis Knight.
Subscribe to the Focus Talk TV YouTube channel. Follow at Focus Talk TV on Instagram and Twitter, and join in on the conversation on the Focus Talk TV Facebook page. And in the meantime, remember to stay focused.
Joe. Blackula.